Hello viewers, welcome back. I am Neha Paryani. In today's session, we will discuss about bills of exchange. So let's start. Bills of exchange. So this is the new chapter that we are going to start today. And this video will be based upon the concept and some terms which are used in this chapter that we need to know. Right? So before coming to the definition, let us try to understand the concept with an example. Alright? So assume that there is a person named A. Right? A is a businessman. A sells certain goods to a person named B. Okay? So here A becomes the seller and B becomes the purchaser or buyer. Right? So now what happens is when A sells certain goods to B, it is the duty of the B to pay the cash or pay the price. Right? But what B does is, he will tell to A that he will pay the amount in future. Right now he is not capable to pay the money, but he will pay it in future or on later date. Right? So this becomes a credit sale. Right? So here what A will do is, he will ask for some guarantee. So he will ask that, what is the guarantee that you will pay me certain money? How can I believe you? So what A does is, what seller does is, he will make a certain bill. Right? So this is a form of written document. Okay? He will make a bill in which it will be mentioned that B will pay him certain money. For example, A sold goods worth rupees 400 to B. So in the bill, it will be mentioned that B agrees to pay rupees 400 to A on a certain date. Right? So this bill will be made by seller. And then it will be given to B, right? B is the purchaser, right? So he will read the bill, and if he agrees it, he will make his signature on this, right? So when he makes his signature, it means that he is agreeing to pay. Now this becomes the bills of exchange for both the parties, right? For A, this is bills receivable, and for B, this is bills payable, because A is going to receive some amount and B is going to pay some amount on a particular date. For example, like B told him he will pay after 3 months. So 3 months will be the term of this bill. So understood, this bill or this document will be known as bills of exchange. For A it is a bills receivable and for B it is a bills payable. Right? So this serves as a proof that credit sales have been made between A and B. Okay? Now coming back to the definition, a bill of exchange is an instrument. Instrument in the sense, it is a financial instrument. Okay? In writing. So as I told you earlier, it is in written format. Right? It cannot be oral. Okay? Containing an unconditional order signed by the maker directing a certain person to pay a certain sum of money on a determined date. See, let's try to divide this definition in some parts. First of all, it is an instrument. It means it is a financial instrument, right? Next, it should be in the written format. It cannot be oral. Then, it contains an unconditional order. So, A is ordering B to pay certain amount. It should not be conditional, okay? It must be unconditional. Then, it must be signed by the maker. Maker in the sense, here A is the maker, right? But it should also be signed by B when he agrees to pay the money, right? If he is making his signature, it means that he is agreeing to pay the money. Alright? Next, directing a certain person to pay. Here A is directing to B to pay certain amount, right? On a determined date. On the fixed date, he will pay the money, right? So, are you clear with the definition? Next, let's try to have a look at the parties to the bills of exchange. So it means that the members who are involved in bills of exchange. So with this example, it is very clear that at least two members are involved, right? One is the seller and one is the purchaser, right? So the seller or the one who makes the bill will be known as a drawer. He draws the bill on B. So A or seller will be known as drawer, right? And the person on whom the bill is made, he will be known as drawee. Okay, drawee. Clear? So at least there are two parties, right? Drawer of the bill, acceptor or drawee of the bill, and the third is payee of the bill. Now here, payee in most of the cases, it is drawer. Payee is the person to whom the money is to be paid, right? So by this example, you will tell that A is the payee because the B will pay certain amount to A, right? But in some cases, the payee may change. Okay, so when the payee can be changed? So it is when A transfers this bill to some other person, like C. For example, A has to give certain amount to C. So he is waiting that he will receive the payment from B, then he can pay to C. So instead of that, what A can do is he can transfer this bill to C so that B will directly pay the amount to C. So here in this case, A will not be the payee, C will be the payee, right? So in some cases, payee will be different. But in most of the cases, drawer will be the payee. Alright, clear? Here we need to remember one thing, that is when A draws bill on B, B will just read this bill, he will give his consent, which means he will make his signature, then he has to return this bill to A again. Okay, so B cannot keep this bill with himself. The drawer keeps the bill. Okay, so when the maturity date arrives, A can contact B and he can ask for the payment by showing this bill of exchange. Okay, then B has to make the payment to A. Alright, next. So what could be the contents of a bill of exchange? So basically there are 5 things which are necessarily to be mentioned in a bill of exchange. Okay, so first of all, we have amount. So assume that this is an bill. So this is drawn by A on B and we need to mention the amount. So here in this case, the amount is rupees 400, right? So now we have mentioned the amount. So this is the first important thing in bill of exchange. Next, it is date. So date here in the sense maturity date or due date, the bill when it gets matured. Okay, so assume that B has told him that he will pay the bill on April 3rd. Okay, so 3rd April will become the due date. Next, period. Here period in the sense term of the bill, until when this bill is valid. So this period will be decided by both the parties. B will tell him that he will need 3 to 4 months of time. Let's fix it as 3 months, okay? So here the term becomes 3 months. B will make the payment after 3 months. So the date on that day will be 3rd April, okay? So here the period or the term becomes 3 months. So this bill will be valid for 3 months, alright? Next, signature. So as I told you earlier, signature from both the parties should be on the bill of exchange, right? So here it will be like sign from A and sign from B. Both have to make the signature. See, for example, assume that when A draws the bill on B and if B does not agree it or B does not give his consent for the bill, so this cannot be called as a bill then. This will be just a draft. So when B agrees to pay, this will become a bill. Okay, and having signature from both the parties will be necessary then. Alright. Next, at last we have stamp. Now having a legal stamp on our bill is very necessary. So it shows us that our bill is legal. Okay, so if we don't have a stamp on our bill, we cannot call it as a legal bill. Okay, so if when the maturity date arrives, if B disagrees to pay the amount or if he says that I was not the person who has signed on this bill, then A cannot file a case against B with this bill without having stamp on it. So this will be just like a piece of paper for A then. Okay, so having a stamp is very necessary. Okay, so these were the 5 things which has to be mentioned in the bill of exchange. Okay, next we have types of bill of exchange. So we already know this, right? There are 2 types, bills receivable and bills payable. So the person who draws the bill, it will be bills receivable for him. And the person who has to pay the amount which is mentioned in the bill will be the bills payable for him, right? So bills receivable will be the asset for the A or for the seller then, or for the drawer then. Bills payable will be the liability for drawee or purchaser. Okay, clear? Next. Now there are certain terms which are used in bills of exchange that we need to know. So this will be used in the problems. So we need to know it now. Okay, first is maturity of bill. The term maturity refers to the date when on which a bill of exchange or a promissory note becomes due for payment. See, promissory note is also like a proof which tells that the credit sale have been happened. But this could be in oral format also. So here when a person promises to pay certain amount to another person, that will be called as a promissory note. And this could be oral also. It is not necessary that it has to be in written format only. Okay, so the date when a bill of exchange or a promissory note becomes due for payment, that will be called as a maturity of bill. See here, 3rd April will be the maturity date or due date for this bill, right? Next, 3 extra days or days of grace are added to the date of maturity. Now, this is a very important point that we need to remember. For every date, there will be 3 extra days. So, we call them as grace days or days of grace. That needs to be added. So, here if in case on 3rd April, B is failed to pay the money, then A will give him 3 extra days. So, within these 3 days, he will have to make the payment. Or he can file a case against B. So, this will be known as grace days or days of grace, which will be added to every bill. Now here our maturity date will become 6th April, right? Okay, next. When the date of maturity is a public holiday, the instrument or bill of exchange will become due on the preceding business day. See, for example, this 6th April is a public holiday, like it is on Sunday, Saturday, or it could be Republic Day or Independence Day, something like that, then our bill will become due on 5th April itself. So, it has to be the working day. Alright? Next, in case of emergent government holiday, the due date will become the next working day. So, if in case we have an unexpected government holiday, then the due date will be the next working day. So, here in this case, it could be 7th. Okay, 7th of April. Alright? Next. Next term is discounting of bill. The process of encashing the bill with the bank is called discounting the bill. See here, it means that giving the bill to the bank and receiving money from bank will be known as discounting of bill. So how this is happened? So let's have a look. Here, assume that this transaction has been carried on 3rd of January. Okay. So from 3rd of January, 3 months will be 3rd of April. Plus 3 grace days, our due date will be 6th of April, right? Now, B will give amount on 6th of April, right? But here what happens is, A needs money immediately. Like on 10th of January, he needs the money. So, he cannot ask B because they have already made the agreement. So, what A can do is, he can take this bill to the bank, okay? So, he can take the bill to the bank, he will give the bill to the bank and he will tell to bank that I need the cash immediately. So, what bank will do is, he will give A the cash immediately. Here, the amount that is mentioned in the bill is rupee 400, right? So, bank will charge some rate of interest on it. For example, 12, 18 or 20, 25% from it. Here, let's assume that it's 12%. Okay, so 12% of 400. So that amount will be deducted by the bank and the remaining amount will be paid to A immediately, right? So this 12% will be benefit for the bank for giving the cash immediately. Now what bank will do is, when maturity date arrives, bank will go and approach B. So B will have to pay the amount to bank. See, I told you earlier, in some cases payee may change, right? Here A will not be the payee. Here the payee will be bank. B has to make payment to the bank. Okay. So this is what we call it as discounting of bill. It means giving the bill to the bank and receiving cash from bank before due date will be known as discounting of bill. here certain amount will be benefit for the bank. A will not receive 400 but little lesser than 400. Okay, next, third term is endorsement of bill. So this I have already explained you. A has to pay certain amount to C, so A again has given this bill to C, so here B can directly pay amount to C. Here there is a transfer of bill, right? Transfer of bill from A to C. So this transfer is known as endorsement. C, transfer of bill from one person to another is called endorsement of bill. Okay, any holder may transfer a bill unless its transfer is restricted. See, here I have given you the example of a seller, but even B can transfer this bill to some other person. Assume B has to receive some payment from any other person like D, or D has to make payment to B, right? So what B tells is, you don't make me the payment, you can directly make the payment to B's creditor, that is A. Okay, so this can also be done. B can also endorse the bill to some other person and A can also endorse the bill to some other person, right? So now endorsing does not mean that giving this bill to some other person, only giving is not important. So what we have to do is, the endorser has to assume that this is a bill. At the back side of the bill, the endorser has to mention the name of the endorsee. The person who for to whom the bill is being endorsed will be known as endorsee, and the person who is transferring the bill will be known as endorser. Okay, so name of mentioning the name of endorsee as well as signature from endorser, these two things are necessary. Okay, so then we can transfer or endorse the bill to some other party. Without this name, mentioning the name and signature, we cannot call it as the bill has been endorsed. Okay, clear? So this was about the concept and terms used in bill of exchange. From my next sessions, we will start practical problems on this chapter. So please don't forget to watch next sessions as well. Okay guys, so this was all about today. If you found this helpful, please hit the like button. Also subscribe to my channel. I'll see you in my next video. Till that, happy learning.